Okay, continuing on with this chapter of the nervous system. I know a lot of the stuff we've already talked about, so it'll be a good review. But look at the picture on page 378. Shows you a pretty good picture of the brain. And like I said, depending upon where the stroke is, it's how it's manifested different. If somebody should have a stroke in the front part of their brain, it's probably going to affect their personality. It could actually change, not all the time, but sometimes could change a very passive person, aggressive, and then vice versa. Take a very aggressive and make them very passive. The speech center is about right in the center of the brain. So if a person has a stroke there, of course, speech is going to be affected. The back lower part of the brain controls our vital signs. So if they are have a stroke back there, we're going to see, temperature is extremely high, even as high as 105 and 106, blood pressure changes, and those a lot of times are the strokes that a person doesn't survive, even a small one, because once you lose the controlling of your vital signs, well, then you can kind of picture what's going to happen. We already talked about this. The right side of the brain controls the left side of the body and vice versa, because as your brain stem comes down, they crisscross. They basically X. The spinal cord, and then from off the spinal cord goes all the peripheral nervous system. Your nervous system has virtually, the motor part that the messages go out and make for movement. And then it has the sensory part, the sensations, the sensing that basically comes back. Some people have had so much pain, like in a foot or a leg or something like that. Now, I don't know if doctors do this anymore, but I know in times past, patients have just gone in and asked the doctors, will you cut the sensory nerve from my left leg or my left foot, because their pain is just unbearable. Now, nothing anatomically changes, but the sensation just doesn't come back to the brain. They don't ask them to cut the motor, because then they couldn't move it, but they ask them to cut the sensory. There have been people with such bad diabetic neuropathy that the pain's just been unbearable. And for some people, they'll describe it like thousands of needles just sticking them in their hand or their foot, dependent upon where the diabetic neuropathy is. Because the diabetes, the tips of the nerves, it just destroys and fries. And it just sets them on fire. And a lot of people have asked doctors to do that. Of course, our sensory organs, the main ones are eye, and I don't think it's here, nope. Of course, you can kind of imagine, it's so much size, and like I said, with glaucoma, it's the pressure that's increasing because the fluid is coming in the back of the eye but not draining out the front. So, of course, that's going to cause an increased pressure in the eyeball. Of course, the cataracts we talked about, that's that clouding. It's like a little cloud literally in your eyeball that blocks your vision. And it literally can make a person blind in the one eye, and they won't even know it. Because this eye is still okay, the cataracts in this eye, and it happens so slow. It's not like a broken bone, kapow, it's one day it's so much different, but it happens so slow, they don't even realize that they've lost sight in this eye. As far as they're concerned, they're still seeing out of both eyes. Cataracts, I know if a person is on like some respiratory meds, I didn't know this until I had an appointment with my eye doctor. And he says, well, we got to watch you pretty close because some of your medicines cause cataracts. you know, I need the medicines to breathe, you know, but I don't want to get a cataract. Well, actually, I did. I had it taken out. It did cause a cataract. And, but, so some of even the medicines we take, you know, can have side effects like that. But a cataract will literally cover that lens, and it just can happen so slowly a person don't know about it. The ear, of course, you know, you got these three little bones in the middle of your ear, and they basically have a lot to do with our balance. Now, one of the things that can happen with the elderly, of course, is earwax buildup. We try to really discourage Q-tips, because a Q-tip is just like a ramrod. You know, when they put the Q-tip in, a little bit of wax may collect on the tip, and what they'll literally do is impact some earwax against the tympanic membrane, the eardrum, and over time, just pack it in there. Best thing is, if they got earwax, is use the earwax softener, and then the nurse flushes out their ears. But
do they ever use earwax candles?
I've never seen them used in the nursing home. I have seen private people use them in the home, but I don't think now in the Midwest. Now maybe in California, because you know different states may do alternative things that other states aren't ready for yet. You know, the first time I saw it, it literally shocked me. Because I heard the person telling me about it, I was skeptical, you know, and then they used it. Oh, that's kind of interesting. I think they're expensive, but, you know.
It's $3 per ear.
Yeah, I thought that was expensive for a straw, you know. But I don't think the nursing homes are really going to use them yet.
But they say that those are dangerous because the candle, they take all of the wax out of your ear, and you have to have some kind of wax in your ear at all times.
True. And plus, I got to admit, I personally, they asked me to try it, and I personally had a little bit of difficulty thinking that, you know, could some of that candle heat up and liquefy and drip down the inside and right against my tympanic membrane, you know? So I didn't try it, you know, but I know around here I've not seen it, no. But anyways, these three bones, you know, if a person gets earwax in there or even an infection, if these three bones have a lot to do with their balance, well, what's going to happen? They get a middle ear infection. Balance is going to be altered and changed. So a lot of times we've got to be aware of that. So the function of the nervous system, of course, is control, coordinate the mental process, provide reflex centers, heart rate, respiratory centers. Like I said, that frank nerve that goes off, it controls respirations. Senses in response to changes occurring both inside and outside the body. Changes that happen to the nervous system due to aging, of course, like I said, shrinks and slows, the two S's. So the response in reflexes slow. They don't respond to stuff as much. Some memory loss, especially short term. Now, this is normal age related. The brain does shrink up to 15%, and that's what does this thing right here. Number two, some memory loss occurs. That's why a lot of times at the very beginning, is it Alzheimer's or is it normal aging? It's hard to distinguish. There is no blood test yet that you can draw somebody's blood. There isn't a CAT scan, you know, yet. They'll probably, for early stages, they'll probably come up with one, but as of right now, it's not. Sensitivity, nerve endings in the skin decrease, resulting in weakness to sense of touch. This is where a person could get a skin care or cut themselves or have a sore on their bottom and not know about it. Some hearing loss occurs, and senses, vision, smell, and taste will weaken. The taste buds on the tongue will decline. You may see a person put 5-6 packets of sugar in their tea to make it that sweet, and you're going there, oh my gosh. But it takes that much for them to basically taste it. The cerebrovascular accident or the stroke, We talked about that a lot, you know. And here again, living 100 so years ago, you have a creek that comes through your farm. The guy 10 miles upstream of you gets mad at you, blocks it off. No water to your farm. What's going to happen? Crops are going to die, livestock's going to die, you're going to die, okay, without the water. Well, it's the same thing with the bloodstream. The blood, life is in the blood. Nutrition, oxygen. If it gets blocked and stopped by a stroke, that section of the brain will basically die. Now, people call a TIA a mini stroke, and a mini stroke is a transient ischemic attack. Transient means comes fast but goes away. At the very beginning of a TIA or a stroke, a lot of times you cannot tell the difference. The only way you can really tell the difference is Tuesday, like if something happens to your resident on Monday, you come back on Tuesday and there's no more slurred speech. There's no more confusion. Then you can look back and say, oh, Monday was a TIA. But when they first happen, you can't tell the difference. So a lot of times people will clear up in a half an hour. It'll be that rapid, that transient, okay? Sometimes a half an hour, 2 hours. And a lot of times we'll send people off to the hospital, and on the way to the hospital, the TIA clears up. And then the nurses at the emergency room laugh at the nurses back at the nursing home. Don't you guys know? No, at first you don't know. And, you know, I have actually gone over to the ER and had confrontations with the nurses because for the ER, because they've called back to the nursing home nurses and made fun of them, you know. And, you know, that was really inappropriate because at the very beginning stages, you can't distinguish. And if the golden hour is really true, that the sooner we start treatment, do we want to wait around half an hour, 45, is this a TIA or is this a CVA? Wait around, you know, okay, what do we do? We're losing valuable time if they want to go to the hospital. And of course, that's what you said earlier about the living wills and stuff like that. If they've got a living will, some of them do, advanced care health director, we may not send them. And we're thinking we should, but their wishes are we don't. And of course, that's what we got to abide by, is their documented wishes.
How does that work if, like, if that's their wishes, but then their family comes in and says, why, you know, are they, and they're trying to sue you and stuff?
If they're their wishes and the family disagrees, well, hopefully, you know, there's been some talking going on. Because when they come into the nursing home, we're going to know immediately. Now, if something happens the next day, I'm talking like months from now, you know, that's been brought up to the family, and they have said, I disagree with Mom, but I'll go along. But the thing is, the person signed this, that's the legal document, that's what we go by. The only way that can be changed is if the family goes to court, declares them to become incompetent, and then somebody becomes the guardian, and then the guardian can then set forth new legal documents. But it takes a court event to basically change it. Now, a person who's disoriented cannot sign a living will or an advanced care health directive. A lot of people mix that up and don't know that. But it's just like if you were having surgery, and you know they gave you your pre-op shot and you were starting to get a little hazy, and they bring another piece of paper for you and to sign, you legally cannot sign it, you know. So it's the same with the confusion, you know. They cannot sign a legal document, you know. If they don't have the living will before they have the stroke or before they have the Alzheimer's, you know, they can't get one. Then somebody will have to go, like say everybody knows that Mom and Dad doesn't want all these heroic measures. Somebody will have to go to court, they will have to be declared legally incompetent, get a guardianship ruling, and then they can sign for it. So that's why we're pushing it so much that people have these before, you know, because if they have strong convictions, you know, they need to have them documented while they still can legally do it. Guidelines, residents recovering from a CVA, of course, they're going to have therapy, they're going to have nursing cares to basically help them restore. On what, 381, you can see the problems that can result from a right or left sided, you know, CVA with the hemiparesis, with one-sided the body neglect, loss of ability to tell, you know, that your body's there. A lot of times that's why people will get sores, because their left hand is just laying down all the time. They can't move it, so here again, we have to move it for them. Aphasia is, of course, they can't speak. There's two types of aphasia, expressive and receptive. Expressive is simply they can't express themselves. You talk to them, they'll understand you fine, but they cannot talk back to you. And that's expressive. Receptive is just the opposite. They can express themselves, but they can't receive it right. They're receptive aphasia. So this is where you may say something to them and they hear something totally different. You say, let's go take your bath. They hear, I'm going to hit you with a bat. You know, it can be that much altered. Trouble understanding messages, emotional lability, up and down, crying 1 minute, next minute happy, loss of sensation, bowel and bladder loss, cognitive impairments, changes in personality, thinking. I mean, the list goes on. Whatever that section of the brain controls, if that section is damaged, that basically will be lost. Shows you that, you know, we talked about this, we've done this with the picture on 382, transferring a person, helping to transfer a resident, support the weak side, lead them to the stronger side. So you've got, in this case, the wheelchair is on her left side. So she must have had the stroke on the right side. Parkinson's disease, a progressive disorder that causes the brain to degenerate. It just gets worse and worse and worse. A lot of people will have what's called the Parkinson's shuffle. It's where they will take little bitty rapid steps with their feet, their body posture. They will lean forward, and because of that lean forward, they will fall forward. They will fall a lot. And then, of course, they will have a lot of shakes, a lot of tremors.
So the big difference between Parkinson's and Alzheimer's is probably the shaking thing, or?
Well, really, a lot of it's so similar, the difference is the cause, you know? And really, when we're talking about all these brain symptoms and manifestations, so many of them are so alike. But the difference is the cause. The stroke caused it, the Parkinson's caused it, the cancer, because cancer can do the exact same thing of all these things. So, you know, it makes it easier to learn, you know, because brain damage is brain damage, you know. The right side of the brain is damaged right about here, a certain thing's going to happen. The right, you know, the brain damage here, a certain thing's going to happen. It doesn't matter if Parkinson's does it, Alzheimer's, or a stroke, you know. But the difference is in the root cause. So yeah, a lot of their symptoms will be incredibly similar with the shaking, with the gait, with the speech problems, with the memory problems. But with Parkinson's, like I said, they have these rigid muscles, they have the shakes, they have these quick steps, they fall, they lean a lot. A lot of times these communication boards, you'll use them a lot, or picture cards, because they will have difficulty with that expressive aphasia, expressing themselves. So they have difficulty with what's called word finding. So here a lot of times the pictures they can point to, or even the letters, they can maybe spell out what they want. Go through the guidelines for taking care of a Parkinson's resident. Because they're a high risk for fall, you've got to have that oversight. You encourage your resident to stand straight as possible, ambulate as much as they can, but they will start to hunch over. Encourage as much self-care as you can. Assist them then with what they can't, with their ADLs. They may need some range of motion because the muscles are getting stiffer. Nutrition plays an important role. Encourage them to eat well, to drink well. Look for depression, report it. And then the following symptoms: severe trembling, severe muscle rigidity, contractures, mood swings, incontinence, constipation, dehydration, weight loss, depression. Report to the nurse. Well, you're going to see them. You will see them as the disease progresses on. Multiple sclerosis basically is a progressive nervous disorder that affects the way the impulses are transmitted to and from the brain. So messages going from the brain to the arm, or sensations coming back from the body part to the brain. That transmission is just messed up. So because of that, you have very similar things to Parkinson's with muscle problems, movement problems, muscle weakness, extreme fatigue, tremors again, same. Reduced sensation, eye movement, poor balance. Sounds a lot like Parkinson's. And like I said, a brain cancer in a certain part of the brain will do the exact same thing. A stroke, exact same thing. So a lot of these symptoms are incredibly similar. It's just that there's a root cause difference. It's just like a lot of things can cause a fever. Not drinking enough water. An infection can cause a fever. You know, just different things. The result is the same, though. The result is the same. So guidelines for MS: assist with ambulation to prevent falls, help them to prevent fatigue, be patient with their self-care, and be patient with their movement, offer frequent rest periods, good skin care, assist with range of motion, don't rush them, watch for stress. Stress a lot of times for MS will cause an increased episode. So we try to not stress them. Again, proper nutrition and fluid, and then, you know, notify the nurse if the skin, red, pale, starts to get a pressure sore, more of a contracture starts to happen, urinary tract infections, and basically depression. Spinal cord injuries, these basically we've already talked about, that if the spinal cord, no matter where it's tore, where the spinal cord is tore, from there on down, the person will be paralyzed. So about the waistline, it's going to be the legs. So that's your paraplegic. Quad, meaning four. If it's higher up in the back, just right below the neck or in the neck, of course, then they're going to be a quadriplegic. So you can imagine a person that cannot move both legs, or a person that cannot move their arms and legs, what type of help they're going to need. Skin care is probably number one, because they're not able to change their position or anything like that. We got to be gentle while turning them. Do range of motion, because contractures on these folks are going to be a problem. When we talked about the use it or lose it, you know, contractures because of non-use will have